time I was in a UAW hall, I could think of was 1973 in California. It's the only time I ever won anything. It was I won a double album of Walter Ruther's Funeral. That was a door prize. But I'm Bob Cash. I'm with the Texas Fair Trade Coalition. I've been a member of 11 unions. Couldn't keep a job. And staffer for several, including the seafarers, the temporary staff of coal miners, and also was chief of staff for a state rep for several years. But been in the union movement all my life, up until 3 years ago. You know, I knew I was against free trade. I knew the free trade was hurting people, that it was taking people's jobs. Around that time, 3 years ago, this job came open, of course, with the Texas Fair Trade Coalition. And I thought I had an idea, you know, well, one of the main problems you had with getting people interested in the trade was that it was just blue-collar workers that these free trade agreements were hurting. And that blue-collar workers didn't get a lot of press media time, didn't get a lot of press. The media kept saying, well, these are just the old dinosaur industries, you know, they have to die out, and we're going to have the information age, and everybody's going to be retrained every 4 or 5 years. And so after I got the job, started really looking at free trade agreements and what they do, how they've affected the United States and how they're affecting the world. It's so much of a vast problem than, and when I say just, I've been laid off and lost a job and lost everything I had, so I don't mean just in terms of that it's not, you know, something that I don't understand, but it's more than just layoffs for blue-collar workers. It's devastating entire communities. It's destroying agriculture, farm communities in every developing country that's in a free trade agreement with the United States. For instance, NAFTA. Once NAFTA was signed, the large agribusiness in the United States was able to overpower the small, sustainable agriculture, corn and bean agricultural economy in Mexico. And destroy the Mexican agricultural economic system. And it was after NAFTA and passed in 19, the North American Free Trade Agreement, that the massive migration of Mexican farm families came to the United States. And you have people like Lou Dobbs who try to use free trade as a white supremacist reason to attack Mexicans in Mexico, when the main reason that you have such a large number of migrants forced to come to the United States looking for work was because of a policy that was pushed by the United States government. Since 1994, 4 to 5 million manufacturing jobs have been lost in the United States due to free trade agreements. These are agreements that our Congress voted for, that unfortunately every president since George Herbert Walker Bush has supported. NAFTA was passed under Bill Clinton. George W. Bush continued pushing CAFTA and the World Trade Organization, Doha Round, which the fair trade movement, labor movement, environmentalists, and human rights advocates, family farm organizations were able to stop George Bush on several major free trade initiatives. One was the free trade agreement for the Americas, which they were going to expand the Central American free trade agreement, CAFTA, to all of the Americas. That was pretty much stopped. He negotiated, Bush, W., negotiated five actually free trade agreements
But we were able to, after the Democrats took over Congress in 2006, we were able to stop the Korean, Panama, and Colombian agreements for 5 years. We were able to stop them for five. Unfortunately, after President Obama was elected, he took up the torch of these three free trade agreements. And sometimes I feel like a skunk at the garden party, because I think most of us, particularly people with unions, know that we don't have a choice in these elections. I have to be careful what I say, because I'm nonpartisan, 501c4, and we know that. But it's just a record. It's just a fact to say that the Republicans and the Republican candidates would actually be worse than President Obama. However, it's also a fact to say that if you look at and see what President Obama ran on, if you look at his statements on NAFTA, his statements on free trade, it is true that he has kept his promises more than any other president and passed more of his promises, campaign promises, into law than any other president, actually, in his first term. However, free trade is not one of those, because if you look what he said during the campaigns, he was going to either renegotiate NAFTA or get out of NAFTA, withdraw from NAFTA. Into the Texas Fair Trade Coalition, we have a questionnaire in which he states that he will not support any free trade agreement that does not improve labor standards and environmental standards from the current the current NAFTA format. And just about in every case, he's not carried out those promises. In fact, after the Republicans were elected to the House, he was able to push through and work hard to push through the free trade agreements for Panama, South Korea, and Colombia. Just last week, AFL-CIO, several human rights organizations, and religious organizations sent a letter to the president asking him not to ratify that Colombia had made progress in human rights and labor rights, that there have been several assassinations of labor union members, and Colombia still is the most dangerous country in the world to be a labor union member or organizer. There's still more murders and attacks, but it appears as if this week the president will ratify, say that Colombia has made progress and the Colombia Free Trade Agreement will go into effect. The main thing I was coming here to talk about is the Trans-Pacific Partnership Free Trade Agreement. It is the agreement that is being negotiated right now with there are eight countries that are listed. Most importantly, in those countries are Vietnam and Brunei, which I believe is a sultanate, and several countries in which we already have bilateral free trade agreements on both sides of the Pacific. However, there's also talk. Not just talk, there's actually negotiations on how to bring Japan and other countries into this, it would be a super NAFTA, be the largest free trade agreement we've had, and unfortunately, as far as we know, because it's been negotiated in the most secrecy of any free trade agreement so far, those parts that have leaked and from statements made by the U.S. Trade Representative, Ambassador Ron Kirk, Dallas's former mayor, it's NAFTA. It's NAFTA for the entire Pacific. And a coalition of AFL-CIO, the Building Trades Department, Sierra Club, Friends of the Earth, several churches and arms of churches have put family farm organizations, human rights organizations, have put together a coalition to try to stop the Trans-Pacific Partnership Free Trade Agreement. And the main aspect right now of trying to stop it is to let people see what's in it, what's being negotiated so far. For the first time, people who are negotiating the agreement and those people who are allowed to see the text as it's being negotiated have now been banned from from releasing any of those texts for 4 years, from last summer. Now, they'll be negotiated and assigned and then submitted to the various parliamentary bodies to be passed way before 4 years is up. But after the trade agreements are negotiated and put forward before the bodies, they cannot be amended. They have to be voted up or down, and that's when the multinational corporations really start their lobbying. Right now, there are besides the people who are connected to the governments involved in the negotiations, there are 600 stakeholders who can see the text of the free trade agreement in the United States right now. There's 600 what they're called stakeholders. Out of that 600, a very few, I believe it's less than 30, are folks from unions, environmental groups, human rights groups, whatever. The overwhelming majority are corporate lobbyists. Corporate lobbyists. But even those who can see the text can't say anything about it because they're under this gag order of not releasing the text. Have you been able to figure out how to?
Yeah, he's ready.
Okay. Why don't we do this?
This is the one of the many books on May Day, 1st of May, the struggle for the 8-hour day. And it's never celebrated in the United States, but this is the only country where they don't celebrate.
And it started here.
It started here, and yet it's celebrated all over the world and not here. The Chicago movement led the 8-hour day struggle in 1886, and a very prominent leader of that movement was Lucy Parsons, who was born here, just a little bit south of Fort Worth in Johnson County. And became a very prominent and famous American radical. That then, and then over the next 55 or 60 years.
There's an action plan, if you go to the Occupy website, any Occupy website, two actions planned in May. Well, more than two, but on the May 1st, there's an action plan.
What are they going to do?
Strike.
They're going to ask people to stay, to not work.
Now that may be a bit, we'll see how much that goes over.
Well, yeah. It surprised me how well it went over in Oakland last year.
Well, yeah. I heard that the longshoremen on the West Coast are going to strike on May Day and have political discussions in the workplace. And I was looking on Twitter and I heard that there looks like there's going to be a lot of major demonstrations in all the major cities. For example, even in Miami, as well as in New York, it looks like it could actually be pretty big. As far as organized labor, probably not, right? But there could be a lot of unorganized workers and service workers and young people out on the streets this May Day, hopefully immigrant workers, but I haven't heard anything. In Dallas, as far as I know, I haven't heard anything about a demonstration being planned, but hopefully there is one. I know that last year there was one, but there was only, it was about 200 people maybe, and there was like free food and there were some speakers, and that was pretty cool, so maybe something like that will take place. That's as much as I know about May Day.